With me now is Margaret Sullivan. She's the media columnist for The Washington Post and a former public editor of The New York Times. She is joining along with my panel that's still here, Mr. Leibovich, Ms. Pletka, and Mr. Kapoor. Margaret Sullivan, I want to start by throwing a tweet back at you. Yesterday, you said, I think, something along the effects of, boy, I'm glad to be the former. It's a good day not to be the public editor of The New York Times. That's what it was. Okay. What would your lead be if you were the public editor of The New York Times? How would you be tackling this?
Well, I actually did write a column about it today for The Washington Post. And although it's not a typical public editor column where you're trying to do something different, which is sort of internal refereeing, I did come to the conclusion that I had no problem with The New York Times publication of this piece, that I think it was irresistible in some ways. And I also think that it had significant news value, that was newsworthy. The complaint I have is, as you said, with the writer of it, who I think, you know, reasonably you could apply the word gutless to it, that while there's a message there, it's not exactly a new message, and I think it's one that would have been much more effective with a name behind it, as with so many things.
Why do you assume it's newsworthy? And I say this for this reason. To me, it's newsworthy depending on the title of this person. What if it's just a mid-level political appointee? Does that make it newsworthy? I mean, that's a question I have.
Well, obviously, the farther up the food chain this person is, the more newsworthy it is. We're told that it's a senior administration official, and I don't think the New York Times would throw that phrase around lightly. So I think it is someone fairly high up.
And some have argued actually that the Times has thrown that title around lightly. I mean, that would be one of the emails you'd be getting a lot of from readers saying, "Hey, what is the New York Times definition of a senior administration official, and is there?" You know, how deep does that go?
Right. Well, Chuck, I think we're going to find out sooner or later, and I strongly suspect that it'll be sooner. I don't have reason to think that, but I believe it will. And I think we're going to recognize the name and that it'll be someone fairly high up. And for that reason, I think that the kinds of things that were said and the voice that the person said it in, which was very personal, I think very egotistical, makes it highly newsworthy.
There's a New York Times Magazine writer here, and I figured, Mark Leibovich, ask Margaret Sullivan what you would want to know on the reporter side of this. This, to me, it's an interesting little issue between the news side and the opinion side.
I will just tell you from within our newsroom today, we are speculating just like any other, I assume, newsroom is speculating, just like we're speculating now. It seems almost obvious to say at this point, but we are completely in the dark. We've asked all the questions that we're asking here. And so I guess that's a long-winded way of saying I have nothing to add on that. But sure. I mean, I guess the thought exercise is, on the question is it gutless or not? The thought exercise is, all right, what if this person has, puts a name on this? He or she probably would get fired, like, immediately.
And probably have death threats.
There would be that whole gamut of things. I mean, and, well, then we would know who they
book
are.
Deal? Is that what you're saying?
Well, they'd have, a great pundit deal, obviously.
We talked about this.
Well, we did.
Break right. About.
No, but no, but actually, no. But, like, did this completely through the front door. Just said, I'm going to the New York Times. I am, and I don't even want to, like, name a hypothetical person.
I don't either.
But the two intriguing questions I have about this and that I've heard actually discussed is, first, how different is it than the Times or the Post or my publication, Bloomberg, publishing, firsthand accounts from anonymous sources in the midst of a story for people in the White House who are talking and offering their views about the president? And the second is, it's not the first time that any of our publications have published stories that we think are newsworthy, but we wonder, why in the world did this person say that or do that, or what is their motive, right? Which also seems to be the case here.
But there's a real circular problem in D.C. right now. Part of it is that the Trump administration feels so beleaguered in some cases, we agree rightly, and obviously in some cases wrongly because of their conspiracy theories. But because of that, there's so much gossip, there's so much speculation, and I can tell you that I have repeated things that I've heard, and then I've had them repeated back to me. And that's the thing that I worry about with this anonymous sourcing is, two guys, I have two sources. Well, yeah, okay, they were the two guys I just told, so.
Margaret Sullivan, I'm curious, what do you tell the reader that sits there and goes, Mark Leibovich claims he doesn't know. How is it that the New York, I don't buy it. How the New York Times, yes, they claim there's a firewall between news and opinion, and you've worked there. I know there is, too. I know James Bennett. I know Dean Baquet. I know how that works. But from a public perception standpoint, and you were the public editor, that's tough to defend.
Yeah, people have a hard time believing that there's really a wall between opinion and news. And, you know, I think we all understand that while there is a separation and that they are two separate departments, that they're also people who work for the same institution. They talk to each other. In this case, reportedly, Dean Baquet was not told and may not know who this person is. I mean, that does strain credulity just a little bit to think the executive editor doesn't know, but he may not. If he does know, it certainly puts him in a tough position with his reporters who presumably are trying to chase this story. So, you know, there's a lot of, and if the New York Times ends up breaking the story
about who this
person is, then, you know, then you've got some real issues, which is why I think it would be terrific if the Washington Post broke this story.
But Mark Leibovich, you can't break the story, can you? Mark is right. Margaret Sullivan's right. Nobody would believe that.
Because I'm not promoting a book.
Yeah, I know. Well, there you go.
About football.
No, we'll find out what the public editor thinks of that.
Look,
I mean, promoting a book instead of breaking news.
That's true. I should be breaking that. I should be finding who wrote that. No, look, I mean, if it creates a lot of complicated, you know, decisions up the tree. Here, I will punt. I don't know. I mean, these decisions will be made at some point. I don't know how hotly they're pursuing that any more than the Washington
Post.
It's
going to be the same.
I mean, I really believe that. I think that if the story, I believe that if the Times reporters are able to determine independently who this person is, I can't imagine anyone at the New York Times pulling them back from running that story. I think it would have to be sent to the lawyers, and I know it would be, but I think the lawyers would find a way to make it publishable, and that would be the right thing.
All right, but I got to ask you an ethics question, just, and it's the last question, and this is what I'm struggling with. If this person is pretty high up, okay, and they're saying these things, and they're essentially talking about the 25th Amendment and all this, this is, at what point does the New York Times have a duty to share this with the public?
I mean, they've made a commitment. The opinion side of the New York Times has made a commitment not to reveal this mm-hmm. person's identity, and I think they have to stay with that. You know, the news side is in a completely different situation and could and should reveal it when they know, but not from the opinion side people.
Well, a tough firewall to figure out where it actually sits and whether it is effective. Margaret Sullivan at The Washington Post now as a media columnist and the former public editor of The New York Times. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Hello, YouTubers. If you're watching this, it means you've checked out our channel, so thank you. Now do me a favor. Subscribe by clicking on that button down there. Click on any of the videos to watch the latest interviews and highlights from MTP Daily and MSNBC. You can get more Beat the Press content every morning in the First Read newsletter. If you're tired of content that you don't know anything about where it came from, you don't have to have that problem with us. NBC News, MSNBC, MTP, and the Meet the Press mindset right here for you on YouTube. Subscribe now.